as you heard just in that song, he spoke and the world was created. Now, there's a term that's used in church world. People say that you're called to do a certain thing. Obviously, God is the one who does the calling. God speaks things into being. They say that death and life are in the tongue, that the power of death and life are in the tongue. Death and life are in the power of tongue, and they that love it shall eat the fruit thereof. Proverbs 18:21, that you can have the fruit of death be on your tongue, or you can have the fruit of life be on your tongue. So is that true? Whenever I hear, I think this word calling, I think that has real import. I think that God calls things into being. So then I look back historically. I look through the word. I go all the way back to Adam and Eve, where Adam and Eve called into being, just like he called all of creation. God called Adam. He called Eve. There was an urgency. He had something that they had to do. There was intention, there was purpose behind what he had for them to do. He didn't just birth them or create them out of the clay and drop them off and say, go for it, you're on your own, right? When he calls someone, he has a bond with them forever. I got your back. Now, Adam and Eve, he has parameters. You shall not, what?
Eat the fruit.
But other than that, I am with you always. I will never leave you or forsake you. Amen. To everyone that he calls. Genesis 1:28, God blessed them and God said to them, here's their calling, be fruitful and multiply, fill the earth and subdue it, have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. Some of us think Adam and Eve were just kind of dropped off and just kind of la 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 la. Are you kidding? That was a lot. That was a huge calling on the two of them. Have we ever really thought what was laid on them? Look at this. Be fruitful and multiply. Okay, they could probably handle that. Fill the earth. They can do their best and subdue it. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, over the birds of the air, and over every living thing that moves on the earth. He called them to this monumental task. But he said, I'm in this with you. Because could they have done that alone? He had to be in it with them. And he gave them parameters. Don't eat from the tree of the knowledge of good and evil, or you will die. But other than that, we're good. Let's move ahead. Let's look at Moses. In Exodus 4, Moses is still standing in front of the burning bush, arguing with God about going back to Egypt. So the conversation has gone like this. God tells Moses to take off his shoes. Then God tells Moses, I have seen
should go.
But Moses says, who am I to do this job? And God says, it's not who you are, but who I am. I will be with you. But Moses protests again, I cannot believe this. Sometimes if you read it, and don't just like skim over it because you've heard the story so many times, Moses says, but who are you? What is your name compared to Pharaoh's name? Who are you compared to Pharaoh? Who is God compared to Pharaoh? Really? Who are you compared to Pharaoh? And then Moses offers yet another protest. What if the Israelites don't believe that you have appeared to me? What if they don't even believe we've had this conversation? As persistent as Moses is in his reluctance, God is even more persistent. Moses is like, I don't want to go. Here's why. You don't understand how powerful Pharaoh is. You don't understand that they won't believe me. You don't understand. But God is like, you're the guy. You're the guy. You don't understand who I am, and you're still a guy. God responds to Moses by giving him three signs to demonstrate that he is God, and as long as he's going with him, he's okay. And we know these signs when he has, what's in your hand, Moses? You don't think I can use you? What's in your hand? I can turn that into a snake. Now put your hand inside your robe. Pull it out. It's leprous. Put it back in. It's clean. God does not accept excuses. Have any of you ever felt called and yet you're so afraid of being called, but God just won't let you not do it? Like, no, you're the one. No, I'm not. I'm not this. I'm not that. The situation isn't this. It's not the right time. It's blah, 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 blah. But you're the one. You're the one. But you're the one. He does not take excuses. God will take whatever's in your hand. And then Moses even said, okay, how about using my brother, Aaron? Because I am not even a very good speaker. Can you take Aaron? Nope. It's got to be you. So this is another example of someone that God called who's not ready, doesn't think he's ready, doesn't think he's called, but he's called. Then we have Abraham. Starts out as Abram. So uncertain of God being with him. God even comes and tells him much, much earlier that all of these things are going to happen. And then because he thinks he's going to move on his own time, okay, yeah, maybe it's going to happen, but I think I can speed up this process. And so he manages to have a child with a servant,
Hagar,
because he doesn't think it's happening in the right time. So he's just kind of making it happen for him, right?
He listened to his wife.
So it wasn't that the calling wasn't true. It's that Abram was manipulating the calling. Not only was Abraham resistant, he tried a workaround around the calling. Once he didn't think God had his back, he told his wife, this was earlier, even before the Hagar situation, called his wife to pretend she was his sister. So he's constantly doing these workarounds because he didn't think God could handle it. It's almost like Moses saying, I don't think you're big enough to stand up to Pharaoh, God. Right? Now let's look at someone in the New Testament, Saul, who then became Paul. Acts 9. Then Saul, still breathing threats and murder against the disciples of the Lord, went to the high priest and asked letters from him to the synagogues of Damascus, so that if he found any who were of the way, capital W, whether men or women, he might bring them bound to Jerusalem. As he journeyed, he came near Damascus, and suddenly a light shone around him from heaven, that he fell to the ground and heard a voice saying to him, Saul, Saul, why are you persecuting me? And he said, Who are you, Lord? Well, the fact that he said, Who are you, Lord, don't you kind of think he knew? Then he said, I'm Jesus whom you are persecuting. It is hard for you to kick against the goads. So he trembled and astonished and said, Lord, what do you want me to do? Then the Lord said to him, Arise and go into the city, and you will be told what you must do. And the men who journeyed with him stood speechless, hearing a voice, but seeing no one. Then Saul arose from the ground, and when his eyes were opened, he saw no one. But they led him by the hand and brought him into Damascus. And he was 3 days without sight, and neither ate nor drank. Saul/Paul was not only looking to hear the call to preach, he was openly in opposition. It was not like Abraham and Moses and these people who were really trying to be God-fearing men. This is a person who was openly in opposition to the purposes of God. And all of a sudden, he heard the call. He had been holding coats while those preaching were being stoned to death. He was on the road saying, I have papers in my hand that says I can bind you up and carry you to the authorities if you are speaking of this man they call Jesus. I have the right to do that. The connection that I want you to make with these spiritual giants. And then I am going to get into Christmas, believe it or not. And I'm going to call this our Christmas hero. Is probably best brought about by Paul. They all received a call from God. And as I looked at their call, I found some similarities. And let me say this. I was 18 hours riding on a train with no internet, just a Bible. And so I had the only research I was doing, I had no one else's notes. I was just doing this, as they say, raw. So everything that I found was just me, the Word, and the Holy Spirit. So I really feel like this was a word from the Lord. The connection that all of these people have with this calling that they hear from God, number one, there was always an urgency that God said, I have got to have you do this. Adam and Eve, I've got to have you do this. And it has to be done in my timing, right now. Abram, don't you make up the calendar when you think it needs to be done. It has to be done when I say it has to be done. There's also Noah. We can talk about Noah. There was an urgency with Noah, right? I mean, I could go on and on and on. I had to cut it off at some point. Adam and Eve and Noah and Moses. said, "I am calling you now." And when Christmas, when God knew that a Savior had to come, He knew who He had to call. He knew the timing. He knew who needed to get pregnant. With Paul, the reason I say that the urgency is made so much more apparent is because all these other men seem to be walking as men of God. But Paul was in a position, Saul was in a position, where he actually was seeking to completely squash the evangelical move of God. The growth of the baby Christian church is like this little sapling. You know how they protect the little baby trees? Because if someone could just walk over a little sapling tree and it just doesn't grow, right? And that's what he was trying to do. So there was that urgency. And he was a man of influence. And he was actively seeking to kill this church. So the first thing is urgency. The next thing, and it's a word that you don't really see much, it's this unction. And this is what you find in all of these people who receive this calling. And God knew that they had this unction. And an unction is an anointing, but it's coupled with this desire and knowing. It's this all combined feeling like, I know that I am made for this thing. You may not have known it before it was presented to you, but when it comes up to you, it's like, yeah, I have to do this. It's that unction. When he is struck blind and he says, "Lord, what do I have to do?" When the Lord speaks to Noah and says, "You have to build a boat," what would you say? Oh, what? There is something in it. There is this unction, this anointing, this desire, this saying, knowing that says, for such a time as this. We're not even going to get into Esther. For such a time as this. That is that unction that you know that you, specifically you, are being called to do that. There is a supernatural purpose that you have been waiting to do. This is what Paul says in Galatians. I really like the way this is worded. "I want you to know, brothers and sisters, that the gospel I preached is not of human origin. I did not receive it from any man, nor was I taught it. Rather, I received it by revelation from Jesus Christ." Now, we know this is true. We know because we know the story of him falling down the road. "For you have heard of my previous way of life in Judaism, how intensely I persecuted the church of God and tried to destroy it. But when God, who set me apart from my mother's womb and called me by his grace, was pleased to reveal his son in me so that I might preach him among the Gentiles, my immediate response was not to consult any human being." Receiving a calling supersedes you going to someone and say, "I heard this from the Lord. What do you think? I heard this from the Lord. What do you think? I heard this from the Lord. What do you think?" When you hear it from the Lord, he tells you this, and it's like, yeah. Yeah. And then the third thing, the similarity that connects these, is the unity. Not that everyone's going to agree with you. In fact, a lot of times, no one will. Moses in particular makes this so apparent when he's saying, but do you know how powerful Pharaoh is? And God says, do you know who I am? His name is Pharaoh. I am that I am. Do you know who I am? Do they know who I am? So, they all have this urgency, this unction, and this unity. So, what does this have to do with Christmas? I don't want you to think at all that Jesus is another one of the people that is called. Because Jesus is the caller, right? He is God. For me, the most obvious first person that is being called was Mary. Gabriel was the messenger. God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth to a virgin named Mary. She was engaged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of King David. Gabriel appeared to her and said, "Greetings, favored woman. Lord is with you." Confused and disturbed. Now you know she's 15, right? Confused and disturbed, Mary tried to think what the angel could mean. "Don't be afraid, Mary," the angel told her, "for you have found favor with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son. You will name him Jesus. He will be very great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his ancestor David, and he will reign over Israel forever. His kingdom will never end." Mary asked the angel, I want you to hear this part, because the angel has just said, you will conceive and give birth to a son, you will name him Jesus. He will be very great, will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him a throne. The Lord God will give him a throne of his ancestor David. He will reign over Israel forever. The kingdom will never end. 15-year-old Mary asked the angel, but how can this happen? I am a virgin. You realize, oh my goodness, she is just a girl. They're like, there's so many questions, right? There are so many questions she could have asked. The angel replied, "The Holy Spirit will come upon you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the baby to be born will be holy, and he will be called the Son of God. What's more, your relative Elizabeth has become pregnant in her old age. People used to say she was barren, but she has conceived a son and is now in her sixth month. For the word of God will never fail." Mary responded, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." It's that unction in her. There are so many things that do not make sense. But somewhere in her spirit, it's like, yes, Lord. There is that unction, the urgency that we needed a Savior. There is only one way. The unction, "I am the Lord's servant. May everything you have said about me come true." None of it makes any sense. How many would have said that? Only one. The Lord knew. Only the right one. And unity. God was with Mary until the very end. Not just a childbirth. I'm not saying in the manger was the end. I'm talking about to the very end of the cross. hold your mother. And that's when he releases his mother to his brother and says, take care of your family. And he says, son, behold your mother. And that was the conclusion of her call. So, why did I want to talk about Mary's call as the first Christmas sermon this year? I'm really trying to be very open with you, the church family. And I was told this week, this past week, not Thanksgiving week, actually it was the week before Thanksgiving, by two families that called in and said that they were leaving the church because I had not been called. And I am human, and there are things that even though you'd like to be super spiritual and you'd like for nothing to hurt your feelings, the human experience is still sometimes laying over everything, and you have to get past that and throw that aside and think, okay, let's think, what's the God in this? What am I supposed to get out of this? So after I got past the feelings, I thought, what does this really mean? So I usually, when something like this happens, I have to pray about it, I have to think about it, I study it, and then I have to determine where I want to go from there. And I try not to take it personal. And then I started thinking about Christmas, and I started thinking about Mary. And I'm not the mother of God. She was 15. She was not married. You know, I'm just whining about someone hurting my feelings. She didn't ask to be pregnant. You know, I didn't ask to preach. Moses did not ask to set his people free. None of the people that asked for these things. That's why I always go to the Word and I'm like, okay, so what does the Word say about this? Did these people ask for this calling? And they did not. But did they rise to the occasion? Only because God was with them in it. Otherwise, they were just really talented people. Right? So, I really did a study on what does it mean when a person is called. And so then, if someone phones me, I don't want to say someone calls me, if someone phones me and says, well, we're leaving because you're not called, then that's not a me problem, that's a faith problem, in my book. If I am God and I say to this body of believers, let's say I'm God and you guys are people, and I said, you know, which one of you would go and preach the word at CCBC? And let's say, stand up, say I will, Clarissa. Or Betty, you do it. Sina, say I will. Will you go preach the word at CCBC?
Sure.
Okay. So I'm God. So I'm going to take Betty. And the whole time she's here preaching, I'm thought she somehow deserved it, but that God chose her for whatever reason, and she was obedient, and she had that unction in her. It's like, I don't know why, but yes. Let me put it another way. Raise your hand if you've had a child. In your belly, you've had a child. Even if your father, who's like had, you know, your wife has had a child. There are times when you're very meticulously planning your childbirth, and, you know, you say, okay, now, it's convenient for us to have the baby on April 3rd, and so we're going to plan all the way back to this date so that we'll have the birth on April 3rd. But most people, you know, they get married and then they just kind of let it happen. And so when they find out they're pregnant, they're like, oh, we're pregnant, right? But then when they find out they're pregnant, especially their first one, they're like, I don't have a clue what I'm doing. I don't know how to be a mom. Well, guess what? This is not unlike a calling, because now there is an urgency. There's a 9-month urgency because it's going to happen. You have 9 months and you better start getting that unction in you. You start reading, you start preparing, you start feeling like, I think I can do this. Yeah, you start feeling like, I think I know this. I think I know. I'm going to love this baby. I'm going to do this. I'm going to do that. And then when you have the baby, father or mother, you really feel like at that moment, if God is not here with me in this, I don't have a prayer. How many parents feel like that? If you don't have God in with you, raising this child, you don't have a shot at raising a normal child. That's kind of what a calling is like. You have to have God with you in that. I don't want any of what I said about me being called or not called to be judgmental, because I know that if you are judgmental, you are judged in the same way that you are judging. It says, therefore, you are inexcusable, O man, whoever you are who judge, for in whatever you judge another, you condemn yourself. For you who judge practice the same things. Romans 2:1. What I really want to bring to light is that she was called to carry the Savior of the world. I'm just called to tell people about him. And I hope I can do that. I think I can, because he is here with me every second that I'm up here. I want him to use each of you this Christmas season to tell his story, to talk about who he is, about how he walks with you, about how he's called you and what he has called you to do, why he came, and why we're each here to tell his story. Of us, and you have a special calling on every single one of us, that unction in us would be clear, that when you call our name, we would be so ready to be obedient. We thank you that that's how much you love us, and that you called Mary for your story. How much you must love us. Let us prepare our hearts as we go out this week. In Jesus' name.